हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वी हैव कवर्ड पार्ट वन एंड हाफ ऑफ पार्ट टू इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो ऑफ चैप्टर वन, दैट इज द बेस्ट क्रिसमस प्रेजेंट इन द वर्ल्ड. लेट्स टेक अ क्विक रिवीजन ऑफ इट. द स्टोरी बिगिंस विद द ऑथर मेकिंग अ डिसीजन अबाउट बाइंग एन ओल्ड रोल टॉप डेस्क विच वॉज इन अ बैड कंडीशन. He had longed for one since long, and he was also confident that he could store it. Thus, he takes the desk home, and as he starts working on it on the Christmas Eve, he finds a secret drawer that carried a letter addressed to some woman called Connie from her husband Jim. It said that it was his last letter and was dated December 26, 1914. It was written at the time of war between Germany and Britain. It enlists the series of events that followed on the day of Christmas. That year, 1914, or a wonderful thing that happened, in the words of Jim. He wrote about how the two armies that came together to celebrate the spirit of Christmas despite belonging to enemy nations. They forgot about their differences for a while and realized that they had much in common. They shared snaps, sausages and rum. The two officers, Jim and Hans Wolf, developed a good bond over a chit-chat. Let's continue our chapter. Ah, Dorset, he smiled. I know this place. I know it very well. We shared my rum ration and his excellent sausage. And we talked, Connie, how we talked. He spoke almost perfect English, but it turned out that he had never set foot in Dorset, never even been to England. He had learned all he knew of England from school and from reading books in English. His favorite writer was Thomas Hardy, his favorite book Far From the Madding Crowd. So out there in no man's land, we talked of Bathsheba and Gabriel Oak and Sergeant Troy and Dorset. He had a wife and one son born just 6 months ago. As I looked about me, there were huddles of khaki and grey everywhere, all over no man's land, smoking, laughing, talking, drinking, eating. Hans Wolf and I shared what was left of your wonderful Christmas cake, Connie. He thought the marzipan was the best he had ever tasted. I agreed. We agreed about everything, and he was my enemy. There never was a Christmas party like it, Connie. So in this paragraph, ration means fixed amount of a commodity officially allowed to each person. Bathsheba is in the Bible, the mother of Solomon, also a character in the book of Thomas Hardy, Far From the Madding Crowd. Gabriel Oak and Sergeant Troy are also a character in the book Far From the Madding Crowd. Huddles means crowd together. Marzipan is a sweet covering on a cake made from sugar, eggs and almonds. So in this paragraph, Hans expressed delightfulness upon hearing about Dorset. He revealed that he knew the place quite well, but it turned out that he had never visited this place or any other in England. He knew so much about England, and all from school or English books that he read. Jim mentioned how they shared his quota of rum and hence sausages. Jim's excitement about the conversation was clear from the letter. He revealed that they talked about Hans' favorite author, that is Thomas Hardy, and his book, that is Far From the Madding Crowd. He told Connie how they talked about the characters of the book like Bathsheba, Gabriel Oak and Sergeant Troy. They talked about each other's family. Hence, too, was married with a 6-month-old son. They even shared the leftover cake that Jim's wife had made. Hence loved the marzipan and expressed it was the best he ever had. Jim was of the same opinion. Jim mentions how they both agreed on everything despite being each other's enemy. He tells how he looked at the no man's land and could see men in grey and khaki enjoying themselves. They were smoking, eating, laughing, drinking, and most of all, celebrating. Jim mentions how it was a very unique Christmas party. Next paragraph. Then someone, I don't know, who brought out a football. Great coats were dumped in pile to make goalposts. And the next thing we knew, it was Tommy against Fritz out in the middle of no man's land. Hence, Wolf and I looked on and cheered, clapping our hands and stamping our feet to keep out the cold as much as anything. There was a moment when I noticed our breaths mingling in air between us. He saw it too and smiled. Jim McPherson, he said after a while, I think this is how we should resolve this war. A football match. No one dies in football match. No children are orphaned. No wives become widows. Here, goal post means either of two upright posts of goal, and mingling means mix or cause to mix together. So, Jim mentions that someone who he does not know brought out a football, and next they know they were having a football match in the midst of no man's land. They used great coats to make the goalpost. Hans and Jim only watched and cheered the teams. They clapped and stamped their feet to keep themselves warm. Also, Jim could even notice their breaths mixing up in the air. Hans noticed it too, and they both smiled at each other. After a while, Hans said that this is exactly how the dispute should be resolved and not by war. In a football match, no one loses their life, no children are orphaned, and no wives become widows. Next paragraph. I would prefer cricket, I told him. Then we, Thomas, could be sure of winning, probably. We laughed at that and together we watched the game. Sad to say, Connie, Fritz won 2-1. But as Hans Wolf generously said, our goal was wider than theirs, so it wasn't quite fair. So in this paragraph, Jim replies to Hans' idea of resolving it with a football match by saying that he would rather suggest cricket because then there would be a more chances of the Tommies winning. Jim replies to Hans' idea of resolving it with football by saying that he would rather suggest cricket because then there would be more chances of the Tommies winning. They both had a good laugh. Sadly, Jim informs that Fritz won the game by 2-1. Hence, generous as he was, remarked that it was because their goal was wider than that of Tommy's, which was a bit unfair. Next paragraph. The time came and all too soon when the game was finished. The snaps and the rum and the sausage had long since run out and we knew it was all over. I wished Hans well and told him I hoped he would see his family again soon, that the fighting would end and we could all go home. So they ran out of rum, snaps and the sausages. The game was finished. Sooner than they realized it all come to an end. Jim gave Hans his best wishes and conveyed how he hoped for things to end soon and end well so that they could all go home and reunite with their families. Next paragraph. I think that is what every soldier wants on both sides. Hence Wool said, "Take care, Jim McPherson. I shall never forget this moment, nor you." He saluted and walked away from me slowly, unwillingly. I felt. He turned to wave just once and then became one of the hundreds of grey-coated men drifting back towards their trenches. So, in this paragraph, Hans replied by saying that reuniting with the families and for things to end well is something that every soldier wants. He then wishes Jim well and expresses that he shall always remember that day, and so shall Jim. Hans went away after saluting in a slow pace and turned back only once to wave. Jim felt as if Hans was walking unwillingly, but soon he was one of the grey-coated men who moved back to their trenches. Next paragraph. That night, back in our dugouts, we heard them singing a carol and singing it quite beautifully. It was Still Natch, Silent Night. Our boys gave them a rousing chorus of While Shepherds Watched. We exchanged carols for a while and then we all fell silent. We had our time of peace and goodwill, a time I will treasure as long as I live. Here, dugout means a shelter for soldier made by digging a hole in the ground and covering it. Rousing means exciting. So, as soon as they went back to their dugout shelters, they could hear the Germans singing a carol very melodiously. They sang Still Natch or the Silent Night, then the Tommies sang While Shepherds Watched. Just like this, they exchanged carols that night and after a while, they were all silent. Jim calls it the time of peace and goodwill and says how he will cherish it forever. Next paragraph. Dearest Connie, by Christmas time next year, this war will be nothing but a distant and terrible memory. I know from all that happened today how much both armies long for peace. We shall be together again soon, I am sure of it. Your loving Jim. After telling her about the amazing Christmas night, Jim tells Connie that things will settle soon and by the next Christmas, the war would be just a distant memory. He tells her that his experience with them has made him realize how both the sides crave for peace. He assures her that they will be reunited soon. He then signs off. Part 3. I folded the letter again and slipped it carefully back into its envelope. I kept awake all night. By morning, I knew what I had to do. I drove into Bridport, just a few miles away. I asked a boy walking his dog where Copper Beaches was. House number 12 turned out to be nothing but a burnt out shell, the roof gapping, the windows rotted up. I knocked at the house next door and asked if anyone knew the whereabouts of Mrs. McPherson. "Oh yes," said the old man in his slippers. He knew her well. A lovely old lady, he told me, a bit muddle-headed, but at her age she was entitled to be, wasn't she? 101 years old, she had been in the house when it caught fire. No one really knew how the fire had started, but it could well have been candles. She used candles rather than electricity because she always thought electricity was too expensive. The fireman had got her out just in time. She was in a nursing home now, he told me. Burlington House on the Dorchester Road on the other side of town. In this paragraph, burnt out means destroyed by fire. Boarded up means covered with wooden boards. And muddle-headed means confused. So after reading the letter, which he knew he should not have read in the first place, he placed it back neatly in the envelope. The narrator could not sleep that night, and the next morning he knew exactly what he had to do. So he drove to Bridport, which was just a few miles away from his place of residence. He asked a little boy who was walking his dog for directions to the Copper Beeches. He went there looking for the address mentioned on the letter, but house number 12 was all burned down. Its roof was all open and the windows were covered with boards for security. To inquire about the whereabouts of Mrs. MacPherson, he knocked at the house next door. The old man in the slippers knew the lady personally. He called her a lovely lady who stayed a bit confused most of the time, but he blamed it on her age, for she was 101 years old. Her house caught fire and she was saved by the fireman. The actual cause of the fire is not known, but people suspect it to be the candles. The old lady used a lot of candles as she thought electricity was too expensive. The old man told the narrator that she now lives in a nursing home named Burlington House on Dorchester Road, which is on the other side of the town. Next paragraph. I found Burlington House nursing home easily enough. There were paper chains up in the hallway and a lighted Christmas tree stood in the corner with a lopsided angel on top. I said I was a friend come to visit Mrs. MacPherson to bring her a Christmas present. I could see through into the dining room where everyone was wearing a paper hat and singing. The matron had a hat on too and seemed happy enough to see me. She even offered me a mince pie. She walked me along the corridor. Mrs. MacPherson is not in with the others, she told me. She's rather confused today, so we thought it best if she had a good rest. She has no family, you know. No one visits. So I'm sure she'll be the only too pleased to see you. She took me into a conservatory and wicker chairs and potted plants all around and left me. Here, loop-sided means asymmetrical and matron means a woman in charge of domestic and medical arrangements at an institute. So the narrator went to Burlington House nursing home, which he found easily. There were Christmas decorations all over. The hallway was decorated with paper chains all over, and at the end there was a Christmas tree with an asymmetrical angel on the top. He introduced himself as a friend of Mrs. MacPherson who had come to give her a Christmas present. He could see everyone at the dining hall. They were all singing and wore paper hats. The matron wore one such hat too. She was happy to see the narrator and even offered him a piece of mince pie. As she walks him through the corridor, she tells that Mrs. MacPherson does not get visitors often as she has no family. According to her, Mrs. MacPherson would be delighted to see him. She mentions that she is not celebrating today as she was a bit confused, so they thought it would be better for her to rest. She took him to a conservatory which had chairs made of wigs and potted plants. Next paragraph. The old lady was sitting in a wheelchair, her hands folded in her lap. She had silver-white hair pinned into a wispy bun. She was gazing out at the garden. "Hello," I said. She turned and looked up at me vacantly. "Happy Christmas, Connie," I went on. "I found this. I think it's yours." As I was speaking, her eyes never left my face. I opened the tin box and gave it to her. That was the moment her eyes lit up with recognition and her face became suffused with a sudden glow of happiness. I explained about the desk, about how I had found it, but I don't think she was listening. For a while, she said nothing but stroked the letter tenderly with her fingertips. Here, lit up means became bright with excitement or happiness. Suffused with means spread all over her face. Wispy means fine. Tenderly means with gentleness, kindness, and affection. So, inside the conservatory sat an old lady in a wheelchair with her hands folded in her lap. Her white hair was tied in a neat bun. As she sat there, she was staring at the garden when he entered. The author went and said, "Hello." She turned her attention towards him as he continued wishing her Happy Christmas and gave her the letter. She constantly looked at his face while he spoke. It was only when he handed her the tin box that her eyes became radiant due to immense happiness. After handing the tin box over to her, he explained the series of events that led him to the letter, but she didn't listen to a word, and he said as she was filled with so much happiness. Nor did she say a word. She just sat holding the letter in her hands with gentleness, kindness, and affection. Next paragraph. Suddenly, she reached out and took my hand. Her eyes were filled with tears. "You told me you would come home by Christmas, dearest," she said, "and here you are, the best Christmas present in the world. Come closer, Jim dear, sit down." So, as he stood there silently, Connie moved and took his hand while her eyes were watery. She said that he had fulfilled his promise of being there by Christmas. She even said that he is the best Christmas present in the world. She then asked him to come near her and sit beside her. She called the author Jim. Last paragraph. I sat down beside her and she kissed my cheek. "I read your letter so often, Jim, every day. I wanted to hear your voice in my head. It always made me feel you were with me. And now you are. Now you are back. You can read it to me yourself. Would you do that for me, Jim dear? I just want to hear your voice again. I would love that so much. And then perhaps we'll have some tea. I have made you a nice Christmas cake, marzipan, all around. I know how much you love marzipan." So he did as she said. He went near her and sat down while she kissed him on his cheeks. She told him how she read his letter daily and it made her feel like she was with him. She longed to hear his voice, but then she mentioned now that he is here with her, he can read out the letter to her in his voice. She asks if he would do that for her. She explains that she just wants to hear his voice badly, and if he could do that for her, she would love that. She suggested that they can even have tea afterwards. She then told him that she even made his favorite Christmas cake with marzipan. She is well aware of how he loved marzipan. So here, explanation of chapter 1 gets over.